بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. Brothers and sisters, inshallah everybody's well. I'm going to do this quick live stream to address a point that's been coming up a lot recently that I've noticed a lot of people are asking. This will be recorded, I think, so it goes up on the channel, inshallah, so you guys can watch this later if you haven't seen this from the beginning. So what I want to discuss, and I'm going to try using the whiteboard to demonstrate or write down some of these things so they become a bit more clear, is this idea that the idea of belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? Now, this isn't a problem just a problem amongst atheists and non-Muslims. This is a problem amongst Muslims as well, right? And I've noticed this, that many of us, due to the society we live in and the world we live in and the people around us, and there's just the way things are, the way things are taught, the way we learn through the educational systems, we end up with these underlying ideas which stem from sort of a naturalistic worldview. And some of these ideas are, for example, that to believe in something or to know something to be true, we need either philosophical, logical argumentation for it or scientific, empirical data. And these two avenues seem to be the only two ways by which we can come to truth, or that's what we're led to believe. Now, I want you guys to challenge this as well and think about this. Although this is the norm of the world we live in today, is this true? Are these the only ways to truth? Or are there other ways to truth? This idea of philosophical argumentation and scientific data or empirical data being the only ways to truth, where does it come from? Why have we ascribed to these standards, and why do we stick with these standards, right? From the Islamic perspective, we know, and which we're going to discuss, that there is other ways to truth. Even from a purely Western philosophical perspective, we know, such as the idea of testimony, right? Testimony is something that scientists rely on themselves. Scientists use testimony to further their science. So for example, a scientist may come into the field of evolutionary biology, for example, and he will take the works of another scientist and his testimony, the other scientist's testimony, and base his work and continue his work from that testimony, right? So it's the testimony of someone that they're relying upon. Most of the things we believe in science to be true are based on testimony, right? So that's another route to knowledge, okay? The point I'm trying to highlight is, even from a non-Islamic perspective, that there are other routes to knowledge, but we don't use them, we're not told about them, we don't exercise them, and we're just purely generally taught to, you know, when it comes to believing in something or knowing about something, we to stick to pure logical philosophical argumentation or empirical data. And this is why when we have discussions with atheists, or when we have discussions with naturalists or agnostics, what they tend to do is they ask for proof for Allah's existence, right? And when they ask for proof, what they normally mean is, give me some sort of empirical data, or give me some sort of logical argumentation or philosophical argumentation, okay? Now, just to put a caveat, I'm not saying we don't have very strong philosophical logical arguments for God's existence, and we don't have indirect scientific data which points towards the Creator. We have those things, and we'll discuss that. But what I'm trying to highlight is that there's more to it. Because in these type of discussions, when we get into a discussion with an atheist, what tends to happen is the atheist asks for the logical arguments, the atheist asks for scientific data, and what we end up doing is we end up entertaining them. We end up getting into a discussion where we give them these things. But what we don't realize is that belief or guidance that comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not purely based on logic. We don't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala purely because we can logically or rationally justify His existence, right? This is not why we believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We shouldn't ascribe to this understanding, because this was the understanding of some groups in the past, right? Which had these distorted views. And some of these views arose because they were addressing philosophers of the past, and to engage them and discuss with them, they came up with these ideas. So we don't ascribe to these ideas. We have the concept, for example, of the fitrah, which is this innate disposition. Again, something we'll talk about. But moving on to the board, inshallah, just to put things into perspective for you guys. Hopefully you guys can see it clearly. On this side, I have philosophy and science. And on this side, I have written signs. Now, these are broad terms I'm using right now. But what I want you to understand is that there's a lot more to these, and we're going to discuss those. So when we talk about philosophy and science, this is basically empirical data. Empirical data from the scientific perspective. Then we also have argumentation, arguments. This is in the form of inductive argumentation normally when you talk about philosophy. So you have premises which lead to conclusions, right? For example, to give you a very basic syllogism, and a syllogism is just a philosophical form of argumentation, is say John is a man, premise one, premise two, John, or premise two, all men die, and therefore the conclusion is John will die. So this is a type of philosophical argumentation, right? And we use this when we make arguments for God's existence, okay? Now on the other side, now this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directs us towards in the Quran, right? And the main purpose of signs is to lead us to his worship, okay? But just as a general point for now, so when we talk about signs, signs are something much more broad, okay? So signs incorporate these things, okay? So that means a philosophical argument can be a form of sign. Just the very fact that we can argue logically and come up with logical argumentation shows that we have rational minds, shows that we have minds which have the capacity and ability of foresight to look into a conclusion, of understanding truth or acquiring truth through these methods. So the fact that we can logically argue is a sign, right? It's proof that there must be a creator who created this, because if you deny Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you're left in a world which is basically the result of blind physical processes, right? Random activities going on, random things going on, random chemical processes, physical processes. Now, the question is, how do random blind physical processes result in a brain and a mind which can think in a logical way, which can come up with argumentation, right? You see the point? So the point is, this itself, these things, philosophy and science itself, you can say, are signs, okay? But signs are much more comprehensive. They encompass a lot more, okay? For example, signs, we know ayat, yeah? And these are probably the most powerful signs. The Quran, you know, when we read the Quran, we normally in English, we say verses, okay? We translate ayat into verses or ayah into verses. But the point is that ayat are signs, okay? They're miracles. They are things that point us towards Allah. They are things that get us to connect to Allah, to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have Quran, okay? Not only this, so we have already arguments, philosophy also comes under this. We have Quran, okay? We also have personal experiences, okay? Now, every single one of us as human beings, whether you're an atheist or a theist, a Muslim, a Christian, wherever you are at the moment, our lives are full of experiences. Our lives are full of events that take place, right? Our lives have ups and downs, things that happen, okay? In our lives, we have occasions where we are in a situation which is a life and death situation, right? So there are things in our lives that happen where we realize that there is no one that can help us except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? There are occasions in our lives where we, you know, may end up in a situation where you may be on a plane, right? And turbulence hits the plane and the plane's shaking and there's no one at that moment that can help you except Allah, right? So when we face death, this is a sign. This awakens something within us. And we're going to talk about this, which is the fitrah, right? This awakens something within us, which makes us call upon God, right? When we're in a life and death situation, we don't give up to death. We don't say, oh, well, death is coming, I'm going to give up. When all hope is lost in everything physical and worldly, all the means, the asbab, then we turn our attention towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, towards God. And atheists do this as well. Every single human being does this. This is a part of our fitrah. It's innate. So experiences, right? And our experiences also break down into other categories. So under experiences, you can have shock, like we discussed, like the example of the plane, where you were in a plane and it may be, you know, you're in a situation, a life or death situation, and you don't know if you're going to survive, and you turn to God and you ask, call out to God. This can be through a beautiful experience. Now, a beautiful experience in life can awaken you to the reality of God. For example, if somebody, you know, helps you in a way which where you're in a situation no one can help you, and this beautiful experience in your life, or something happens, you need money. Say you need to pay a bill, and if you don't pay it, they're going to take your house. Somehow money comes to you, right? And this just makes you realize there is no way this could have happened. Such an experience can turn you towards God, right? So experience could be of both types. Both these things can awaken that fitrah within you, can awaken your heart, right, and turn you towards God. So signs also include, like we said, argumentation, scientific evidence, it could be philosophical argumentation, it could be Quran, experiences, different type of life activity, personal experiences, right? signs are all around us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran tells us that the creation of the heavens and the earth. So again, a bit to do with the scientific stuff, where when you observe the physical world around you and the reality around you, this will point you towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? So the universe. And the list goes on. But the point, brothers and sisters, that I want you guys to understand is this. As you look at this, as you can already see that the let me just turn the camera a bit so you guys can see this. Apologies about the light. I know there's light reflecting on the board. But the point is, brothers and sisters, that science incorporate a lot more, right? Allah's giving us a lot more things to lead us to His worship or lead us to Him than the way we perceive reality and the criteria we give ourselves, right? So the point is this. When we ask, when we say, oh, for me to believe in God, you have to give me pure scientific evidence or a pure philosophical, logical argument, and that's it. I don't want nothing else instead of these things. This is all I want. And then I will see if I want to worship Allah. What we're actually doing is we're pigeonholing ourselves. We're limiting ourselves. We're closing off all the other doors which could lead us to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is a position of arrogance. We arrogantly assume that we need pure logic or pure scientific data to believe in God, right? And we're not going to take anything else. This is a position of arrogance, right? And arrogance, we know, is one of the biggest barriers to guidance, okay? Whereas Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and think about this, look at what Allah is giving us. You're asking for something very small and shallow, but Allah is saying, I'm going to give you something far more profound. I'm not only going to give you argumentation for my existence, I'm not only going to give you empirical data which indirectly points towards existence, because science can only deal with the physical world and physical things, so it can't directly prove or disprove Allah's existence, right? But indirectly, you can look at the universe and the complexity of the universe, and you can ask the question, well, what does this point towards? God or no God? And obviously, when you look at the nature of the universe and the fine-tuning and all of these things, it points directly towards God. So Allah is saying, I'll give you all of these things, plus I'll give you personal experiences in your life that will turn you towards me. I will give you the Quran, which is revelation from me, which are full of signs, right? Which will get you to connect to me, come close to me, awaken your heart, okay? I will give you, other signs within the heavens and the earth and within yourselves and so on and so forth. So Allah is giving us something far more great, right? Allah is giving us something far more comprehensive to lead us to His belief than just a shallow, one-size-fits-all philosophical, logical argument. Do you see the point? Right? So what we're asking for is something so small. Give us a generic, for example, a generic logical argument for God's existence. One size fits all. But Allah is saying, no, I'm going to give you that plus, out of His mercy, things which are more personal to you. Things that apply to you specifically, every single human being. Not just a generic argument. Allah is giving us far more. This is why when we see some people, some brothers and sisters that come to Islam, some of the most beautiful reversions or conversions to Islam are when someone opens the Quran and they read one verse, and that verse at that moment applies to their life and it makes complete sense. And that just triggers the fitrah within, that awakens their heart and they know this is from Allah, right? And with another person, and this, on the same day, in the same hour, he opens the Quran and he finds another verse, another ayat, another sign which applies to him. And that leads him to become Muslim. So Allah is giving us something far more comprehensive. And the point I want, the reason I started this off as well, is to highlight that for us as Muslims, first and foremost, we need to remove these shackles and barriers that we've developed through our educational systems and our upbringing, which is we need pure philosophical argumentation only or scientific data. This is the paradigm the world around us creates, and there's no reason to hold on to this paradigm. Throughout history, if we look at, minus these 100 years, throughout history, people have always naturally believed in God because they've understood that we're not only physical beings, we're spiritual beings. We're not only rational, we're spiritual. Okay, there is other elements to us, right, which are far more powerful. And we know, any Muslim knows, that when you're connected to Allah, when you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the certainty that your heart receives from Allah, the guidance it receives, gives you more certainty than any philosophical or logical argument can give you, okay? Now, although I'm making the point that this is the case, let's broaden our ways of thinking and coming to truth. We'll switch on that, if you like, the internal internal receiver, okay? We have this internal spiritual receiver. Switch it on, open yourself up to the guidance of Allah, and this removes the arrogance from you. Because what you're saying then is, I am open. I am open. God, if you exist, I am open. Show me guidance. Direct me. I don't know which way the guidance is going to come. But what I'm going to do is, I'm not going to limit myself to pure philosophy, pure logic, or pure science. I'm going to open myself up to other means of truth, other ways of attaining guidance, basically. And this is what we need to understand as Muslims, and this is what we need to share with non-Muslims as well. So instead of always entertaining them and telling them, look, you want a logical argument for God's existence? That's fine, I'll give you logic. But tell them, you know what, I can give you a powerful logical argument for God's existence, but I'm going to tell you something more. There are other means to truth. God is giving you something far more than just pure logic. God is saying, I'll give you signs which are personal to you. Signs all around you, right? So this is something very powerful. The last point I want to touch upon before I conclude is why, right? Why? What is the purpose of argumentation? What's the purpose of philosophical arguments, logical arguments, the Quran, the ayat in the Quran, personal signs? Why does Allah give us these? It's to trigger our fitrah, as Brother Hamza says, to awaken our internal fitrah. Because we know from the Islamic tradition, and I'll probably touch upon this in another video because it's something I'm looking into still. We know from our tradition that there is this concept of the fitrah. Now, the fitrah is something which is innate within us. Allah has created this thing within us, which is a part of a metaphysical makeup, meaning a part of a non-physical makeup. Okay, just like we have the ruh, we have our spiritual heart, we also have the fitrah. Okay, where the fitrah is, Allahu alam, I don't know. Okay, but the point is, it's there, and this almost by consensus of the scholars, we know that the fitrah, through the fitrah internally, we know God exists. It's an innate internal position. It's something Allah created within us, the knowing of Allah, right? Also, the belief in Allah is natural. If you look at yourself, look at the world around you, we naturally conclude there has to be a creator, right? Denying God makes no sense from any angle. We could probably touch upon this in another video. But the point is that the belief in Allah is innate. It's within us. Allah has placed this within us. What happens is, through our social upbringing and so on and so forth, it gets covered, right? It gets, I wouldn't say it gets distorted because the fitrah is always there. But it gets covered, okay? Now, what you do as a da'i, when you're speaking to people, or even for yourselves, ourselves, right? When we are trying to connect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we need to realize this. So what we have to do is not convince ourselves Allah exists, but what we have to do is clean our fitrah, right? Awaken our fitrah. How do we do this? Well, it could be through many means. Like we said, all of these things that we've outlined here are means to guidance. Allah can make any of these things a means to someone's guidance, okay? So again, the point is, I'm not saying don't use logical argumentation or scientific, indirect scientific data. Sometimes you may need to use it. Sometimes you may be speaking to someone where they may need a logical argument which affects their fitrah and awakens their fitrah or uncovers their fitrah, okay? So this is the important thing. But what we have to realize, and the nuance is this, that we're not using arguments when we give da'wah to prove Allah's existence. And therefore, we believe because we have logical arguments and we can understand those and we can come to the conclusion God exists. No. We believe because it's innate. We believe because it's natural. But what an argument does is it helps to trigger that thing within us, awaken that thing within us, if Allah wills, inshallah, right? So this is the key. So with some people, they may not need logical arguments. I've seen this myself. There are people who are already on a journey. They're looking, they're searching. They don't need logic. They don't need philosophy. They don't need science. If anything, if you give them this, they want to turn away. They're not interested. They're beyond this now. They've gone past this. What they need is something spiritual, something deeper, right? They probably need ayat from the Quran, verses from the Quran. For example, someone may need to know that Allah is close. For example, Allah says, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ إِبَادِي أَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. Allah tells us that when my servants, Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when they ask you about me, tell them I am near, I am close to them. Someone may need this reassurance, this knowledge, this knowing that Allah is there. That what they're searching for is there, is very close, right? They just have to turn towards God. Someone may need to be going through depression and may have tried all of the things in this worldly life, like alcohol, drugs, whatever you may have. Yeah, they may have done all of these things, but they don't find peace. So someone like that may need to be reminded that ayat, the sign they may need from the Quran is that hearts find rest in the remembrance of Allah, right? They may need this. This is what they may need, right? So so have a toolbox, what I'm saying, brothers and sisters, when you give da'wah. Have your logical arguments ready. Have your philosophical arguments ready. Have your indirect scientific data ready, right? And that could be, you know, the fine-tuning of the universe. Have all of these things, but also have the Quran. And the Quran is more powerful than all of these things because the Quran also has arguments within it, okay? It has spiritual arguments that trigger you from that angle, and it has logical arguments too, okay? It has everything. The Quran has everything a human being needs. Have the Quran ready. Memorize the Quran. Make it a part of your life for your da'wah, right? also remind them maybe of their personal lives, of their personal experiences, when they may have been in a life or death situation. And they may have in that situation realized there is no one else to can call upon except Allah. Allah tells us in the Quran, I don't know the exact place in the Quran, but Allah says that when people are at sea and high waves come over them like canopies, right? And they've realized that they are facing death in the face. At that point, they call out to Allah in sincere faith. And then while Allah rescues them, Allah takes them out of that danger and returns them to land, at that point, they turn away, right? So this is the reality of human beings. So we need to remind people, many people have that experience in their life. So as a da'i, be holistic. Don't just limit yourself to logic and philosophy and science. Have something which is far greater with the Quran in your toolbox. Make the Quran a part of your life. Study it. Bring it into your da'wah, inshallah. And that's what I wanted to get across. And remind people, broaden your horizons. As Muslims, we love argumentation, but we understand what arguments are for, and we keep them in their place. We love science, but we understand what science is, and we don't turn science into a god, and we keep it in its place. You know, at the same time, we introduce to the world that there are other means to truth, such as there are other things that can trigger the fitrah, which are spiritual truths, this innate disposition, the fitrah, which is in every human being. The Quran, which is ayat, right? Signs from God. Remind people of these things, right? And do this with confidence, because one reason you will realize, and I can guarantee you this, a little homework here. You may watch an atheist video, and the first time you watch it, you may be impressed, right? You may be impressed. You think, this guy's in a suit. He's using very eloquent language. He knows what he's talking about. Although you may not understand what he's saying. Watch the same video again, but this time pay attention. Maybe don't look at the monitor. Just pay attention to what he's saying. And when you listen to them, you'll realize that what they're saying makes no sense, right? It's all gibberish. It's just nonsense, basically. So the point is, be confident. Confidence goes a long way. And this is something we don't do. Be confident in your da'wah is all. Jazakallah khair, brothers and sisters. Inshallah, this has been beneficial. If you guys have any questions regarding these types of things or the da'wah or anything else, leave them in the comments below, inshallah. What I'm going to try doing, I can't promise if it's going to be once a week or whenever, is whenever there are some important questions that come up, I'm going to try to address them, inshallah, like this. So you guys can benefit as well, inshallah. And I can benefit, because the best way of learning is to teach, inshallah. So whatever I say to you is for my own self as well, so I can internalize these things. It's not just that, you know, I'm trying to do something only for everyone else, for myself first and foremost, inshallah. So if there's any questions, please do ask. I'll try to address them, inshallah. And remember me in your du'as, brothers and sisters. And also remember, you know, whenever we do something or go in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, don't let shaitan attack you from the perspective of telling you that now you're doing something great for the sake of Allah. You know, you don't really have to focus on yourself anymore. Put yourself first and foremost, brothers and sisters, because many times, you know, we forget ourselves when we're trying to help others and guide others, and shaitan takes us away from the path, and before you know it, we're burnt out, we're finished, we can't even help ourselves, let alone others. So focus on yourselves, inshallah. Best way to do that is connect to the Quran the best you can, inshallah. Jazakallah khair. I'm going to end it here, inshallah. Any comments, any suggestions, please leave them at the bottom, inshallah, so you'll help me with the next one, inshallah, whenever I do it. Assalamu alaikum.